In Limousin, there are more cattle than people.
These are Limousin cows. They are free range and lovingly pampered. They are such cow-like cows. They're almost like fairy tale cows.
And despite their gentle appearance, they are beef cows. With true regional pride, Serge Lajoudi, a local farmer, explained why Limousin beef is so good.
Qui a une viande un peu spéciale. C'est une viande persillée que beaucoup de races n'ont pas.
À cause de la nourriture?
Non, à cause de les fibres de la graisse et à l'intérieur des fibres de la viande. Alors que d'autres races ont la graisse autour des fibres de la viande.
Monsieur Lajoudi certainly knows what he's talking about. He comes from a long line of prize-winning beef farmers, and his cows are exported for breeding stock as far away as Australia. Three generations of the family live on the farm. Monsieur Lajoudi's mother, Léa, is making her own version of blanquette de veau, the classic French veal stew. She starts by sautéing pieces of veal shoulder until they're crisp and brown and all moisture has evaporated. The cattle may be prize winners, but there's no room for sentimentality on farms. When the meat has browned, sliced shallots and onions are added. Water goes in and the bottom of the pot is scraped to deglaze the cooking juices. Then salt, pepper, and after it comes to the boil, mushrooms are added. In the classic, more expensive version of blanquette, the stew is thickened with eggs and cream, but Léa, as a thrifty farmer's wife, uses cornstarch and water. The stew will simmer gently for 1.5 hours. Blanquette de veau is traditionally served with boiled rice. In fact, rice is about the only food the Lajoudi family needs to buy, as their farm is almost completely self-sufficient.
On fait du salé aussi, dans un pot, du salé, et c'est bon, hein, ça. Les autres peuvent pas tenir, elles cassent.
C'est deux fois par mois, elles deviennent folles, évidemment. Oui.
Mention Limoges and most people think of porcelain, the finest in France. Ask a farmer and you'll get a different answer. Rue de la Boucherie, Street of the Butcher, has been the center of the city's meat trade since the 13th century. In the 19th century, there were 58 butchers in the one street who all intermarried and had their own powerful corporation or guild.
This is the house of the butcher. Everything took place under one roof. His wife gave birth to the children upstairs. The family lived there. And here, the cattle was bought, slaughtered here, cut into large pieces and left here to hang, to mature. Then it was either sold fresh or cooked on the premises and sold in the shop here. This is the counter where the butcher wife officiated. It was made of marble with the initial, a very elaborate setting. It's easy to see it was a very, very rich corporation. But altogether, this was a very convivial place where people came to buy and gossip. And when the mother came with that child, they were given coffee and advice, and even the child got a little tiny piece of kidney.
After the French Revolution, the Butcher's Guild bought the chapel of Saint Aurelian, the saint who had become their patron. Inside, even the baby Jesus is treated to a tender morsel of kidney. One thing you'll notice in France are the different, perhaps unfamiliar, cuts of meat. They're also very well trimmed, no fat, no gristle, just the necessary bone and cartilage to give flavor and texture. In France, we use relatively inexpensive cuts of meat for one of our most famous dishes, pot-au-feu. This hearty, glorious meat and vegetables boiled dinner is the most reassuring and the most satisfying of dishes. And it has been said that pot-au-feu is the foundation of the French nation. Now, I'm going to use a variety of bone and meat for this pot-au-feu to provide flavor and texture. I've got 1.5 pounds each of short ribs, brisket, and rump of beef. This is just enough water to cover the meat. And when this comes to a boil, I will add vegetable and herbs. This has to be prepared ahead of time, so all the fat can congeal when it is refrigerated, come to the surface, and it's easy to discard. It's come to the boil now, and I've skimmed off the gray froth. The flavorings are onion studded with whole cloves, fresh parsley, bay leaves, garlic cloves, thyme, a chopped leek, and a chopped carrot. The meat will cook gently for 2.5 hours at a slow simmer. The cooked meat is removed from the broth along with the vegetables and flavorings. If you cool the broth in the fridge, the fat will harden and it is then easy to remove. When it's time to serve the pot-au-feu, reheat the meat in the original broth for about 40 minutes. I like to steep the vegetables separately so they stay firm. I've got here celeriac, carrots, and potatoes. Serve the broth first with toasted croûtons and grated cheese. The boiled meat and vegetables are served with sea salt, gherkins, and mustard. In case you were thinking that meat is the only thing eaten in the region, the Limousin countryside offers a hidden treasure.
Bonjour André. Ça, c'est très gentil. Ça, c'est des beaux champignons. Les premiers.
Oui.
Formidable. Et merci beaucoup. C'est très gentil.
Magnificent, Sepp. The first wild mushroom of the season. Madame Florence du Manoir de Jouet has a title, a chateau, and strong culinary traditions. The mushrooms are to be cooked to her mother recipe. First, lard is heated, and garlic is added and briefly sauteed. Further south, olive oil would be used in this recipe, but cooking in animal fat is very much a tradition of this part of France. Then the chopped mushrooms are added to the pan and seasoned with salt and pepper. Finally, chopped parsley goes in. In fact, the mushrooms are not going to be eaten right away, but preserved for later. The recipes Madame du Manoir uses have been passed down through generations. This is another way for a waning aristocracy to maintain its values and transmit its heritage. After she puts the mushrooms in a clean jar, she will sterilize the jar by boiling it for 2 hours. This is the castle's real treasure. Preserved mushrooms, pork liver pâté, chestnuts, and a hors d'oeuvre to see the family through the long winter months. Spring water comes from the center of the earth. The raindrop slowly drips through layers of earth and rock. It is a slow, patient, and wonderful process. The water is filtered and enriched, and it suddenly comes forth loaded with terrific virtue. We have long believed in the health-giving property of mineral water. The Auvergne region is a major producer of bottled water. A French person drinks about 75 liters of mineral water a year, a habit that's as entrenched as drinking wine. And why do we drink it so much? Well, it's said to cleanse your kidneys, liver, and skin. The advertising promises health and youth. And frankly, it's now becoming a lifestyle drink. But taking the waters is nothing new. For centuries, spas like this one in Royat, with its different sulfurous springs, have catered for curistes, people with various complaints. For 3 weeks, they drink mineral water, immerse themselves in it, and even eat a diet of vegetable cooking it. But even the most serious curistes may tire of boiled carrots and be tempted by the culinary glory of Pierre Mioche. At the Hotel Radio, a refined version of Auvergne cuisine is served using local ingredients like salmon and lentils. Monsieur Mioche is transforming strips of salmon fillet into roses. The tiny green lentils from the nearby town of Le Puy have already been boiled with herbs until tender. Monsieur Mioche heats them with a little single cream and will keep them warm until they are needed. The salmon roses are sauteed in a mixture of oil and butter on one side only, so that the salmon is crisp on the bottom and tender and moist on top. The lentils provide a creamy base for the salmon roes. Pierre Mioche's touch of extravagance, a bouquet on a plate. Blue cheese, poached pears, brioche and pink peppercorns. Monsieur Mioche makes inspired desserts. The brioche heart will be used as decoration, while the diced brioche crust is the first layer of the dessert. The sliced poached pear becomes the second layer. Finally, a slice of fourme d'Ambert, the famous Auvergne blue cheese, is laid on top. The dessert is then put under the grill until the cheese melts. Poire à la fourme d'Ambert. If the gentle cattle of the Limousin region look like dairy cows, these Auvergne cattle resemble the cave drawings of primitive beasts, which are in fact their ancestors. But the milk from this breed of cows, called Salaire, makes some of the best cheese in France.
Bonjour, Monsieur Morin.
Bonjour.
Vous êtes en train de passer la torche à vos fourmes?
Oui, je nettoie la croûte uniquement de la fourme.
Comment allez-vous?
Ça va très bien, je vous remercie.
C'est très humide, hein? Vous avez le canal là, je pense, non?
Eh bien, ici c'est très important pour la cave qu'il y ait l'humidité, c'est-à-dire...
Qu'est-ce qu'il y a dessous là?
Dessous c'est un canal. Un canal qui passe l'eau murée et qui renvoie l'humidité.
Ah oui, qui émerge tout au long. C'est tout dans l'affinage. C'est l'affinage qui rend vraiment unique votre fromage, finalement.
Oui, c'est très important. La fabrication compte beaucoup, mais ensuite, c'est comme l'éducation. Il faut éduquer nos fromages. Et nous avons, vous avez ici plusieurs sortes de fromages. Voilà un fromage qui a environ 30 jours d'affinage.
C'est un Salaire.
C'est un Salaire, mais 30 jours. Ensuite, nous avons des fromages entre deux, qui sont ceux-ci, là, qui ont environ 7 mois, 6 à 7 mois. Nous surveillons toujours la croûte grâce à la sonde où, de là, nous pouvons apprécier la texture, la couleur, l'arôme et ensuite le goût. L'Auvergne dispose de 6 appellations.
6 appellations.
Alors... Le Cantal, voilà, le bleu d'Auvergne, le Saint-Nectaire,
oui.
La fourme d'Ambert,
qui est bleu aussi.
Le Salaire, nous distinguons toujours le Salaire avec sa plaque, qui est d'une plaque rouge, hein, et le Layol. Le Layol, vous avez un Layol ici. Alors ça, c'est la truffade.
Ah, c'est ça que vous allez faire.
Voilà, je vais vous inviter, je vais vous faire une bonne truffade.
The cheese is actually immature Cantal, which is cooked with potatoes.
M'expliquer tout parce que j'ai jamais fait truffade.
Voilà. Alors dans l'huile très chaude et bouillante, vous versez, elle est bien assez chaude, voyez.
Oui.
Les pommes de terre.
Oui.
Les deux sortent. Je mets tout.
Non, un seul, ça va aller.
Un seul,
ça va aller.
Voilà. Et on fait chauffer. En brassant.
Alors je peux tourner ça.
On voilà.
Alors donc
je vous laisse faire.
On tourne pour qu'elle soit quoi? Croustillante et moelleuse.
Soit croustillante, oui.
Il n'y a pas de sel, il n'y a rien là.
Non, c'est après.
Bon.
The potatoes cook for about 20 minutes until they are crisp and mellow.
Si vous voulez, vous pouvez goûter.
J'ai goûté.
C'est pas salé.
Très bon, c'est pas salé.
C'est très bon pour le monde.
Alors là, d'après vous, c'est comment là?
Voilà, là c'est bien cuit.
Là ça a l'air bien cuit.
Très bien, parfait.
Alors donc il y a des petits bouts croustillants.
Il faut absolument, c'est ce qui fait.
Ouais, des petits bouts croustillants, oui, je vois.
C'est ce qui fait la truffade, c'est ce petit bout croustillant qui est au milieu.
Voilà. Parfait. Donc on met un petit peu de sel.
On ne peut pas en mettre beaucoup. Là il y en a assez. Vous brassez un petit peu. Voilà. Et vous remettez dessus. 30 secondes. Voilà.
Je mets ça un instant.
Un instant, et c'est bon.
Alors maintenant, c'est le moment
crucial.
Voilà, hein,
c'est le moment important.
Alors, je mets tout ça.
Voilà, en écartant bien, assez vite, s'il vous plaît. Voilà, on baisse le feu complètement.
Oui.
Dès que vous avez fini, fermez le feu. Oula, trop fort. Voilà. Et là, vous tenez bien. Et vous brassez. Je pense. Maggie, qu'est-ce que tu en penses?
Oula! La force là! Oui, en effet. Il y a encore une fois.
Oui.
Moi, j'ajoute un tout petit peu de sel.
un tout petit peu de poivre.
Voilà, on va bien brasser. Voilà. Là, c'est idéal. Idéal.
Alors, attendez, maintenant, de l'ail, hein, c'est ça, vous m'avez dit, de l'ail.
Voilà.
Et un peu de persil.
Voilà, pas plus.
Pour la couleur.
Pour le goût, pour la couleur, de l'espérance.
Et maintenant, on goûte chacun.
Ah oui. On va voir si d'abord elle refile une dernière fois.
Oh là là, c'est magnifique. Il y a des morceaux, c'est tout ce qu'on veut là. Parfait.
Voilà.
Alors, chacun. On dit la vérité, hein, là. Qu'est-ce que vous en pensez, vous?
C'est très bon.
Parfait.
Si jamais, il faut pas les. Vous les faites bien retourner de là-bas au resto, hein. Et vous m'écoutez, hein? Il faudra passer en bas, là-bas, sous le sapin, et bien fermer. Et vous tirez que quand la bête est passée. Avant, vous la faites retourner, pour qu'elle revienne au bois.
Il faut qu'elle veuille retourner.
Et... Whatever my own feelings on the subject might be, I can't deny that hunting is still an important activity in rural France. It's in the autumn, starting from about September, that venison starts appearing in the shops. Whether venison comes straight from the hunt or comes from the supermarket, our tastes have changed. We no longer crave for the highly gamey taste of the past. We cook venison today as we would a leg of lamb, or we leave it overnight in a highly flavored marinade. These cubes of venison shoulder are for a stew. The red wine marinade is flavored with juniper berries and coriander seeds. I leave the venison to marinate in it overnight. Fry the marinated venison cubes in oil until they are brown. By the way, this is a dish that's just as good if you use beef. Now, deglaze the cooking juices in the casserole with red wine vinegar. Then add flour, stirring all the time. This liquid is the marinade the venison was left in. I've strained it and kept the vegetables. Keep stirring it to avoid lumps. The flour will eventually thicken the liquid. This sauce is what the venison will cook in. To the venison, I'm adding chopped shallots and garlic, the marinated vegetables, and the thickened sauce. Finally, a bay leaf and some thyme. Stir everything together and simmer for 1.5 to 2 hours until the meat is completely tender. When the meat has cooked, add button mushrooms. These have been sauteed for 4 minutes. Then add red currant jelly. This will sweeten the pungent flavor of the juniper and coriander. Stir the jelly well so that it melts completely. Flavor with salt and pepper at the end of cooking so that you can fine-tune the balance of sweet, salty, and spicy. Cook for another 15 minutes before serving. Ragout de chevreuil, venison stew, is a hearty dish with warm, earthy flavors. The Auvergne is a rugged, mysterious region, isolated by its inhospitable climate and terrain. Everything the countryside has to offer is enjoyed with immense gusto. It seems to me that hunting simply provides a good excuse to gather with friends, eating and drinking for hours and hours. Auvergnat food is hearty, there's no other word for it. The charcuterie, the sausage and especially the cured ham are known throughout France. The deer's liver is sautéed and served with a mustard sauce. This is the ceremonial high point of the feast. And as the honored guest, I'm offered the first taste.
So this is the liver, the very essence of the wilderness around us.
Cuisine to thrill any palate in the BBC book which accompanies this series, Mireille Johnston's French Cookery Course, and there's a tour of six more regions in the new year.